Morning, windmill. See ya.
Hi, I'm Tony Fastdaughter.
I'm Tony Fastdaughter.
I'm Tony Fastdaughter. My family's been blessed as a farm in Montana for over 100 years now.
And it wouldn't be possible without the great team we have
and blessings from our Savior Jesus Christ.
Excuse you.
There's mines here and they're loading coal trains. Yep, that's all a big conveyor belt that it goes up in
each big. That was a big
And what is that, Daddy?
They're making electricity there.
They're making what?
The electricity.
Just not enough for the whole state of Texas.
Yeah.
You know, when those wind turbines freeze up, you gotta rely on Wyoming coal power.
Yeah.
And Fort Peck Lake water power, hydro power.
Power. Is that what Bodie Brown always says?
Power.
Power. We got our sandwich maker in the back.
What?
You're our sandwich maker?
Yeah.
Yep. And then there's just two other passengers in the middle.
Freeloaders.
They'll have their turn at sandwich making.
Yeah.
The driver's up front. What's up?
Corn prices. Just like you were telling somebody what we're doing.
Yeah, but I'm talking to like this inanimate object. I'm used to good facial expressions. This thing doesn't do anything in return. Yeah.
So on a whim, we decided we're going to go south. Actually, it was a buddy in Texas. Y'all might know who he is. Jay Hill says, let's go south. And I thought he meant Mexico for a vacation. I'm like, yeah, we're in. He meant South Padre Island in Texas, which is basically Mexico. But through a friend of a friend, we found a vacation house that we're gonna go stay at after we go see Jay in Dell City.
Is that a mine truck, Daddy?
Is that what? No, that's a garbage truck.
Oh. I even know what it is.
Sorry.
So we're driving from basically the Canadian border to the tip of Texas.
Like as far from north to south as we possibly could go, probably?
True, I'm pretty sure Texas is further south than...
How come it's...
We should look and see.
It's gonna be
what
a long drive.
Latitude. Would it be latitude?
Right?
Latitude.
It's gonna be a long drive.
So?
It's supposed to be 28 hours.
28 or 30, yeah.
Well, yeah, 28 hours, but we're going to take a detour and go see Jay and Katie and Familia.
Yippers.
I travel forever with you.
What?
The fact that I said something romantic and you, like, hacked up your lung after the fact.
Now look at that one.
I travel forever with you.
Yeah, there goes a mine truck full of coal. Look how full that is. What if that was our grain cart for harvest? Oh, there's another one right there. Going underneath of us.
I can't see anything. Oh, you can click on this. Is it coming through? Is it coming through? I wonder if this little guy feels a little bit inferior. It's okay, little windmill. We still like you. Road conditions, Tony.
Thought Wyoming would have a few more snow plows out.
There.
Like one would be nice.
I don't know if you're gonna see him very well in here.
Finally.
What?
Snow plow.
Oh, I thought you were talking about the mountains. Here I am ready to admire the mountains. Did you got the camera out to document the one snow plow we saw on that stretch?
Yeah.
He's a few hours behind. Hey look, another windmill.
Hey windmill.
And sheep. Look at how beautiful those mountains are, though. You cannot see it on here.
It's like the hills back home.
Whatever. Oh my goodness.
Well, due to blowing snow on the interstate and some crashes, it's closed from Wheatland to Cheyenne, so we're cruising around Wheatland. What else would we do? Look at farm equipment.
buy discount boots.
Oh, there's some balers back there like mine.
Well, the interstate appears to finally be opening up.
What you doing? What you doing?
YouTube things.
Editing.
Editing.
Pecan orchards.
There's some young ones. Some more developed ones. Where are we? Roswell?
Mm-hmm.
Just went by or kind of diverted around Roswell, New Mexico.
Look at that.
Montana, there's snow drifting. Mexico, there's dirt drifting.
Did you say Mexico or New Mexico?
All right, we made it to Dell City, Texas last night, and it's t-shirt weather here.
And jacket.
And light jacket weather. Man, it's nice down here. Sure beats the 28 below we had at home a week ago, huh, girls?
Yeah.
Jay and I are gonna go make a loop around the farm, go check stuff out. Little like alfalfa green and starting to green up.
Starting to green up.
Some wheat that's winter wheat and oats and stuff that's greening up, so.
Yeah, we'll go look at, we'll go tootle around the old ranchito. What do you say?
Works for me.
All sorts of equipment stashed like under any bit of shade in the Southwest, right?
We don't really have an off season where we can put stuff into a really nice barn.
Or so. Really a need for it.
Oh yeah, I mean we farm 12 months out of the year. So everything keeps moving. It's easy to put 1,500 hours on the tractor a year or more because they get to run so much. But they just finished, Brandon and the guys just got done with the swathers. And we run four of these W235s. And these machines run probably 22 days out of a month. So they run pretty hard, and they run hard. So it's nice having these things ready to rock and roll for the season already.
So the short off season's a whole lot of work just to keep equipment ready.
Yeah, so I mean, we finish cutting and baling. We gotta figure out how to get rid of these birds. They're pooping on everything. But yeah, the off season's pretty short. It's really middle of December through January. And then like right now, the guys are out, we're planting oats today, and it gets busy. It gets real busy fast. And then by April, it's full steam.
First cut's coming off and.
Yeah, so we should be cutting hay by about the 15th of April. And then every 28 days until December, we're cutting hay, so.
It's a lot different than, let's go plant one crop, nurture it, put it in bins, and then freeze up again.
Well, that's
so
why
a lot different here than at home.
Yeah, I mean, for us it's the power of people.
Yeah,
you know, it's just having really things that we've wanted to do is find people that want to run hard.
And yeah,
you know, not only on the agronomy side, not only on the mechanical side, but sales and just keeping people engaged, doing a good job, and wanting to make this farm better every day.
Yep.
It's tough, but We got the team that can do it.
And the climate that allows it.
That's true. Yeah. We need some rain though. Take that. We got 3 inches of rain last year.
Three.
So yeah.
I think we had that in a week.
So
we can get that in a week.
The tillage tractors, it's funny because we try to run a difference between balers and tillage tractors. We don't want to run the same, we don't want to tear the guts out of baler tractor, but at the same time, if you can utilize them, you know, in the off season to run something easy. So like a 235 is a cultivator tractor, but like this 320, that tractor's got 10,000 hours on it. It's a baler tractor, but it'll run a light bucket in the off season, just doing some laser leveling work and stuff like that. People always ask, when are you going to trade? You know, why aren't you running all new equipment? Well, there's no sense in running new equipment when you're going to put that many hours on it a year. You're trade-in value just goes crashing. Yeah. So we run them till they're done. There's a red one over there for you, Tony.
There's a couple of red ones here. That one.
I think it's the only case besides the backhoe we have out here.
Mercedes.
So that's a V what?
It's a V8.
V8 Mercedes with no muffler.
Yeah, no, we lost the turbo and it threw oil all the way through the exhaust system. So muffler and DPF and all that was shot. So
bye.
We deleted it and couldn't find a muffler that seemed to fit right. So yeah. This is straight piped.
You gotta feel the horsepower now.
You feel it, you can feel it.
So little balers, big balers, steamers. Bunch of you guys that hay in the northern country probably have no idea what this is all about, but basically making natural dew or simulating natural dew with steam.
Yeah, we're in such an arid climate that our window to be able to put up high quality alfalfa, especially pre-monsoon storms, I mean, you could go a month with relative humidity of 9 and you just shatter everything that you try to bale.
No matter what time of night.
Right, yeah, it could be 2 o'clock in the morning and the wind would be blowing like it is today and you just can't get, you can't put up good hay. The guys at Stolle, I mean, this right here is eliminating 2.5 balers. So if we didn't have this, we would be running 3x4 balers. And now we're running 1. You know, we run four 6110, which is our older series, but parts availability, support, all of that stuff has been fantastic. And so we run 4 of these and we run 2 standard 2270 Massies. And then we've got 2 brand new 2270 XD, the high density balers. Those will be here in 2 weeks. And so like right now we're running 4 1-ton balers, the 4x4 balers, and then running these, but we're gonna take 2 of the 4x4s out of the operation, have 2 as backups. So 6 balers. And then small balers, we run 3 of the 348 John Deere's. John Deere small baler makes a really pretty bale because it mixes with that auger. It makes a really pretty, physically attractive bale. Physically attractive? Is that what I'm supposed to say?
You say whatever you want.
Okay, that's awkward. So, but the bale looks prettier because it mixes the hay. So if you have dew striping or something like that on the alfalfa, it looks really good. But as far as that, the way that the bale is, the repetition of the bale coming out being the same dimension all the time, we struggle with that. The operator's got to be really aware of how much hay they're feeding in, because you'll have inconsistencies in bales. And then we bale bearing everything. So if you have a bale that's, you know, 37 inches long and one that's 32 inches, when the bell bearing gets it, it doesn't stack right. So we went to Massey's, I think they're the 1845s Massey's inlines. They're slower than the John Deere. They don't make as pretty looking as a bell, but they're perfect.
Push them harder.
You can push them hard. Yep, they do really good.
What's the market for your smalls?
We go, Texas is kind of the biggest market for us. And then we do a lot into Florida. We do a lot into North Carolina.
So mostly horse market with the
small squares is all horse market.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then the big squares are alfalfa for dairies or cattle operations. And
we've got some dairies that we are very, attached to. What I say, we want to make sure that we're planting crops based on what their needs are, long-term relationship with those dairies, and it's been great. We're very thankful for those guys. Don't sleep and farm, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah.
Watch
out for stationary objects.
It's a center pivot, like it's irrigation, so it does move, but it was not moving when this happened.
The fun parts of farms, right?
Yeah, everybody wants to on social media. Everybody's like, oh, look at how perfectly polished it is. This is reality of what happens. But the guys at Caterpillar have been good, and they've got us parts coming back out. We should have this thing, I think, the end of next week. Nice thing was it's still mobile, and the guys have decided. Brandon Gibb is our GM, and we were planting all of our cotton with an 8360R. And those tractors had 12,000 hours on them and it was time to retire. And we wanted to use the newer technology in these Challengers. And so Eric and Jesse and Brandon kind of came together and they took the system and we're just having our welders custom build. I haven't been painted or anything yet. I've been cleaned up. They're just dry fitting it. But this is gonna hold our pre-start fertilizer for our cotton planter. And then we run a 40 foot cotton planter that's on the 3-point,
And so Tony was saying it, the ballast, you know, the nice thing is whenever you got these things full, at least you're ballasting out what's happening in the back end.
Leverage out the front a little better.
Yeah, that's the biggest thing is just making sure. Turning is so hard. And then we run a 40-foot strip till that's 3-point as well. And so
you just put like water in the front for then.
Well, we've got, yeah, I mean, and that's probably, actually this tractor won't pull. We've got another 1038 Challenger that will be on the strip till rig about a month ahead of this. So, which is next week. Being the best is about having the best equipment. And
that is one great way to lock a file cabinet.
Yeah, I mean, efficiency.
I mean, there's probably not a torch in here or anything either, is there? But get yourself in there if you had to.
Please don't give anybody ideas. patent pending.
So what does one of those barns hold tons-wise? 1,000 tons?
They hold 1,200, right at 1,200. 3x4 bales.
So 800 ton if
if
you're really, really
pushing it. You're probably about 900 ton.
Yeah. 800 of non-steamed alfalfa.
Yeah, and like that's what we're looking forward to with the XD balers is just being able to get, you know, if we can get some good 1,500-1,600 pound bales.
Yep. Consistently that way, not like your highs.
Right.
Yeah.
And it just helps us on freight. You know, we've got storage stuff so far. It's better on us for hauling, it's better on the dairy for stacking. It's not as much material, you know, it's less bales but more tonnage.
Well, you imagine Rex trying to store round bales?
That's
that takes up a lot of room.
Round bales, what are those?
But they all have swamp coolers yet.
Right, so there used to be a government work program called the Vicero program, and that's where Mexican nationals could come across and work, and then they were able to take all of their funds and wire them back home. And this valley was predominantly vegetable production, tomatoes, a lot of fruit, cantaloupe and watermelon, all kinds of peppers and cabbage and onions, and it's because they were able to get enough labor to do it. And so they built those, that's called Camp 45, and so they built those camps. And they have like one house was a full kitchen. And
okay.
And then they had four guys that lived in each house. And
basically, it's a man camp of the oil field.
Yeah, it's like a man camp.
50 years ago.
Yep. And that's how they did all of the manual labor to do everything. The crazy thing was, so there was a bunch of ranchers in the area before they started farming this in the 40s. This was all ranch country, and all the ranches didn't run fences. They all just put all the cattle together, and then this was a low spot where there was a lot of grass and water. And so when they would work cattle, they'd all come in together.
Okay.
And then as water was discovered and the technology to lift water from the aquifer, it totally changed.
Sure.
And this all turned into farmland instead of grazing land.
Huh. So let's say there was enough water to produce crops, it was more profitable than do that.
Yeah, they were drilling for oil and they found water. And they put it on the cover of Time magazine, the Valley of Hidden Waters, which is still what we're known for. And then it was just like the modern day gold rush. There was like over 2,000 people that lived in town.
Wow.
And little farms everywhere. And now it's, you know, there's 250 people that live in town.
And like, it was probably self-sustaining back then.
Oh,
equipment,
yeah.
And
we get to see all these pictures, and it's just so cool of what the town used to be. That's a large part of what we are, is we just keep looking for people that want to an online business or something like that that would come and contribute to the community, because agriculture's changed here. We're all big farmers.
Yep.
And so the ability for us to bring in so many people is changing now. We're having to use, you know, technology and mechanization. And so small towns like this are starting to die. And unfortunately, we're part of the solution, but we're part of the problem because we're getting more efficient at what we do.
Yeah, it takes less manpower, so your towns dwindle.
Yep, looking at some grapes now. So we just got done pruning all of these. This is Cabernet, this is Riesling,
Not table grapes, but wine grapes.
This is all, yeah, all wine grapes. So this is a very old vine Cabernet. You can see we have a cane, meaning you've got your standard vine, and then it comes up and there's another wire or cordon. And so our vineyard manager, our viticulturist Philip, has trained these. So we've set two sections of fruit for this variety, where if you look at the variety across the street, that is a single. So there's only, there's still another cordon above it, but we are not grafted up to it.
Eventually that will get up there or
nope.
Not?
This is... So this is a lot more, the one on our left is a lot more vigorous than the one on our right.
Okay.
So the Cabernet is going to want to produce more wood, and this is going to want to produce more just regular vegetation.
Okay.
And so this is the best style for the white grapes over here to load the most grapes, and then this is the best style for us to load red grapes.
So what's the age of these vines?
This group of cab is a 2006, 2004, and then these are a 2005. But we go all the way back into the 70s with some. There's
really?
there's a Morvedra that's up at the top. That's one of the older varietals in Texas.
Wow.
And this group of grapes makes fantastic wine. Like, it just makes good wine. I mean, well, I would put this wine up against Napa Valley. I'd put it up against some French wines. Like, it, wow. It makes, and it's just the high salinity in the water. It's the climate.
The environment it's around.
Yeah, it's an environment. Terroir is what they call it. But it's, yeah, it's good drinking wine. Won't give you a hangover. That's a lie.
Jay, they're good looking, but they're not Kenworths.
Yeah, they're better.
Yeah.
Yeah, these are the girls.
So busy moving hay and storage of trucks now, so now you're doing your own trucking.
Yeah, we decided to get into the trucking world this last year, and we wanted rigs that the guys would take pride in, and we're probably going to add another two or three trucks this year.
And baby steps, get into it, see how it goes, and expand, huh?
Yeah, we'll just kind of see where the road takes us. No pun intended there.
Yeah, I'm sure there was.
That thing is an animal.
That is an impressive machine.
Those Wilcox boys know how to build tillage equipment. Like, the field that tractor's running in, that was a 40-inch row spacing, but it was a furrowed bed.
Yep.
So the bed was probably 13, 14 inches tall, and it takes it back down to completely flat and level in one pass. I mean, this is one pass with that Wilcox, and it just destroys it. It's beautiful. And if we're putting a cover crop back in, it's planter ready. Like, we don't have to do, we just run a drill over the top of it, put the borders up, and you got ground ready to go.
So you're, like, that's one big difference between northern farming and desert farming is your soil is so much different that you have to do the tillage. You don't get the frost to break up compaction, and that soil's got to be turned to make a seed bed again.
Yeah.
Otherwise it gets so hard. And
a lot of people think we're crazy too, because we're taking a more minimal approach to tillage. I mean, we just passed that gnarly tillage machine, but with our alfalfa production and things like that, if we're cutting seven or eight times a year, you're running a swather, a rake,
compaction,
the baler, yeah. Then you've got the semis and the wheel loaders. Like, it's just, you know, for 4 years, it's just getting compacted. And so then we'll go back in, and all we want to do is break the hard pan, like that Wilcox. We'll go back in and break the hard pan with the ripper or the Wilcox, and then we'll plant the cover crop back into it. We just planted a cover crop on this. And, you know, 5 years ago in this country, nobody grew a cover crop.
Yeah.
It just blew.
Yep. So, and you're putting that wheat or oats or whatever in there just to get something to hold the soil in place, and then you're going to plant the next crop directly into that.
Absolutely. Yeah. We're trying to get to where we do for rotation purposes, we want to touch that ground one time in 5 years.
Yep. And so you're getting to be like Mar, the Mar conservation way of farming in the desert, really.
And for water usage too. We've got to be smarter at the way that we till our soils.
The more times you till it, the more times it dries out, or the more it does dry out. So
yeah, absolutely.
And you once you hit it and plant it and irrigate it again, it's going to hold that moisture.
If you move your soil, you lose that water profile or your moisture profile. And once that moisture profile is gone, it takes so long to get it back.
Yep. Well, you go up to the I states where they have to till to dry the soil out, and you're the opposite here.
Yeah.
They're trying to hold that moisture.
We've got
to
break it for compaction, but at the same time, there's a fine line to running too wet here. For tillage, we'll actually turn water on sometimes just to get a little bit of moisture in there so we can get it in the ground. If not, if it's dried out all the way, you forget. I mean, you'll just run through points so fast that...
Yeah, so much abrasion.
Yeah, it's rough.
These are pineapple harvesters.
Yeah.
West Texas pineapples or mushrooms or... This is a cotton picker.
So that right there is where my center punch, every one of you guys are commenting about. Where did a center punch come from? So I got the center punch in the shop. That's a spindle.
The only thing you gotta worry about with using these as a center punch is there's so many layers of chrome that are put on each one of these spindles. And sometimes if they're weak and you punch, then that chrome will shatter.
Oh yeah.
So always wear protective gear when using a spindle as a punch.
I don't know if Grandpa must have bought them that
way. They were good though.
They're hard.
Yeah. Oh yeah, they're real hard. Yeah, so cotton picker, these spindles are what actually pulls the cotton off of the plant. So these bars right here are rotating.
They're spinning and going round.
Yeah,
round.
Each individual spindle is actually spinning counterclockwise while this is spinning counterclockwise as well. So it's pulling the cotton off of the plant, and then there's a set of doffers that look like a hubcap with like almost like a gear that's spinning the opposite direction, and it pulls the cotton, the gear goes between it and it cleans it off. And then these are moisture pads, and it puts soap and water onto the spindle to allow the cotton to slide on and slide off when it goes through the doffer.
Just like a combine.
Same thing. I don't know anything about a combine.
These things are massive.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's a big machine when they have to, like, go into transformer mode to get them down the road.
Yeah.
It just keeps going. This is about the same size as a Wilcox front to back.
Probably about the same size. Yeah, so in field mode, this entire system comes up, the baler itself comes up, and then this is the accumulator, and the accumulator comes up as well.
You say you didn't know anything about round balers.
But this is like a man's round baler. So you get so much cotton in there, and then the sensor tells it, okay, it's time to transfer it to the baler. The baler wraps it up, and then we've got this yellow plastic.
It's like the net wrap for hay bales.
Whatever. And then that, it's got an adhesive strip on it, and these belts spin, and it feeds it in, puts the adhesive on it, and then you got about 5,000 pounds of raw cotton
in one spot. And then you can also, do you have to stop to kick it out onto here?
No, so while you're rolling, this tray right here will be in operation mode, so again, everything will be up. The cotton bale rolls out onto this while you're still picking. You've got the accumulator baskets, so that can still be filling up with cotton while it's dumping. Yep. And then whenever you get to the spot in the field that you want, then hit the button, the tailgate comes down and drops the bale off while you're on the move.
So you can actually hold a ton of cotton. Tons of cotton.
Tons of cotton.
While you're moving. So it's like the combine and the grain cart all in one.
See, that's Spanish for yes. I think Case makes a better picker than John Deere.
But they're just modules.
I think it picks, like, if you went from the front end forward, I think Case has got it figured out because they pick on both sides of the cotton plant.
Okay.
Where John Deere is all in line, so it has to pull the whole thing through.
Yep.
But John Deere is light years ahead of Case when it comes to what's happening on the back end. And ease, transport, you know, we can throw these things on the trucks. We can haul 10 round bales, 50,000 pounds, very easy to the gym, and in cases doesn't have that.
But and it's a patented thing, right? Like this is John Deere's patented
this
picker.
Yeah, this is all Deere. This beautiful machine right here is for sale. So if anybody needs a cotton picker, this one's hit the market.
There you go.
Or trade for a combine. So, but yeah, these machines, you can pick 12 to 1500 acres per machine. Pretty comfortable. I know there's guys that do a lot more than that, but for us, we want to stay somewhere between 12 and 1500 acres per machine. And Jesse's done an unbelievable job of keeping these machines in tip-top shape. I mean, they really, these are, you know, this is a 2012 and a 13, I think, and they're immaculate. I mean, they're in great shape.
Lots of moving parts to keep moving.
Yeah, I mean, a typical down season, like if you wanted to go through a cotton picker and you spend, if you take it to a shop just to do head work on it, you can spend upwards of 60 grand. So,
it's crazy.
You know, it's just, there's a lot of maintenance to them.
And last time we were here, we got a ride for a few rounds in them.
Yeah, you got to, did you drive?
No, I just rode with Jesse, I think.
No, you see, he's selfish like that. They didn't even let me get in the cotton picker this year.
Well, when you told me about picking up a rock, starting a fire, I was like, my combine will like kick the rocks out, but this doesn't.
Right, so that's the fire is our biggest fear, and this is all air. So we, as the cotton's pulled off the machine, it dumps down in here, and then it's a big vacuum that sucks it and blows it into the accumulator basket. Well, those heads are spinning, you catch a rock and it creates a spark, and you've got dry cotton. The second it catches it, this turns into a gigantic flamethrower.
It's a forge.
Yeah. So I mean, it just And I mean, it's we caught this picker on fire this year, and you know, the guys were quick. I mean, able. And usually, what we'll do is if we catch a fire, we'll turn the head off, turn the fans off, and then we'll transfer all the cotton into the baler, and then run the baler as fast as it'll run. And it'll smother that flame in the bale and then kick it out and get away. And then about 5 seconds later, the bale just goes. So, yeah, it's not cool.
Not cool at all.
But the machines are really cool.
What is the loss difference between flood irrigation and your drip? Like percentage wise, 20% loss in to evaporation?
It's about 30%.
Okay.
Yeah.
So now that you're putting drip underground, that's feeding the roots the moisture rather than the top and feeding weeds and all that other stuff.
It's a lot. It seems like it's a bigger pain in the rear end because of gophers and things like that. But at the same time, our ability to transfer nutrients right to the root system is something that is a game changer.
And you have 100% effectiveness of your nutrients rather than
You don't have anything, you know, burn off in the atmosphere. Yeah. You don't have anything. And then as far as carriage loss, like putting too much water on and the water just falling out from the bottom, you eliminate all that because as the crop needs it, you know, and these guys have done a good job, we put soil moisture sensors in where we understand the ebb and flow of what that water is doing in the soil profile. You know, as the crop is needing it, we're giving it just enough to keep it thriving.
So you're basically, you can cover 30% more farm ground with the same water.
Depends, but we hope to be able to stretch our water out like that. But like a year like this, where we've gotten 3 inches of total rainfall for the year, drip is a hard thing to grow, especially if you have the tape too deep, because it takes so much water to get seed.
So there's no water profile from nature that you're trying to fill that all back
in. So as long as we can maintain, you know, 8-10 inches of rain, you know, 5-10 inches of rain, drip is phenomenal.
Yeah.
Flood on a dry year, good, because
you're need
pushing
that.
The water across the top of it. But, you know, there's less than a quarter of, I mean, about 10% of our farm is flood irrigated. And depending on, you know, cash flow and what the future holds, I would love to see our pivots start to come down, drip start to come in, all of our floods start to go away to drip. You know, we can grow 4,000 pound cotton, you know, with blindfolded on drip where you just have to work your rear end off to do it on any other style.
Sure.
saving water and better for your bottom line.
Yeah, it's better for the environment. I mean, as far as, you know, you're just, it's a better use of our natural resources. And, you know, where parts of Texas are really having a hard time with their water tables dropped out of sight and they're really worried. I still want to be doing this in 20 years, so I don't want to lose my water.
Yep.
And so we've got to get responsible with the way that we, and we're limited. Our water district limits the amount of water we're allowed to put out a year. And so if you go over that, you're screwed, you're out, you're done. So for us to manage that water, to make sure that we've got water for a long time, is something that we are going to continue to invest in to make sure that we've got it.